So yes, my name is Amada Giles, and this talk is called Amp Up Your Admin. And I actually did just give it a couple days ago at WordCamp Miami, which was amazing. This talk, just so you know, is it's going to be some code snippets. If you're not a developer and you decide you want to get up halfway through and leave, I will not be offended. I'm also going to let you know it's maybe about 20 minutes, so it's not a super long talk. Just a little bit about who I am. I put a snowy picture in here because for all the people in Miami so they could see. This is not from this year, but we do still have some snow up where I live in New Hampshire. So yeah, I'm from New Hampshire. I've been working as an independent IT consultant for over 10 years, using WordPress since 2009. At that point, it was just a little bit of what I do, but now it's almost exclusively what I do. I started speaking at WordCamps in 2014, including Boston's, and hoping to speak again this year. And I find it's great. I also run a meetup up in New Hampshire, the Seacoast New Hampshire WordPress meetup. So if you happen to live north of the city, you might want to just get on our group and come if a topic is of interest to you. WordPress theme developer, yes. Last year I also was part of starting a web development agency, a WordPress development agency called Spark Development. So we're four developers and we specifically just do WordPress development projects. Just on the fun side too, I'm also a kettlebeller. I just hit my 2-year anniversary. I started a kettlebell gym and I absolutely love it. I write some poetry and I'm very well known. Yay! Kettlebellers in the house. I'm also very well known for my epic sneezes, so haven't had one for you tonight, but so you may have looked at the title of the talk and been like, what is she talking about? Amp up. And what this talk came out of is just years of being a theme developer and over a period of time adding, a little more to my bag of tricks of little things that just make your site easier to use for your client or make it a little more professional. So we're going to go over some snippets about that just customize the back end, the look and feel, ones that make it easy for your clients to contact you, ones that make it easier for them to access their data a little more easily. Also making the content editing experience look nicer, look like the front end of the site. And just in generally, I guess I repeated this twice, but it's a big part of it to me is just providing access to your client. Your client isn't necessarily, if you're a developer developing sites for clients, your client may not be technical, they may not be super comfortable in WordPress. So some of these tips are just going to be ways for you to make it easier for them to work with the content that they need to. And this talk it's basically all little code snippets, and I'm not going to step through the actual code snippets just because that would take a really long time, but the code snippets are here really just to show you how small they are and to just emphasize that you don't need to go install a plugin that does something like this. If that's the only thing you want to do, all of these code snippets are, I just find that they're really accessible, they're really small, and so if you're comfortable reading code and writing it, then I suggest you just give it a try. Every plugin you install increases the possibility of a security hack or a performance hit because maybe it has 10 things in it. You're only going to use one or two. So that's the idea. So the first place that this started, probably the first customization that I tend to make for clients, is to change up this screen. So this is the standard login screen. That's great. It promotes WordPress. But, you know, it would be so much better if, for instance, it looked something like this. Which, as you can see, this was for WordCamp Miami. But not specifically like this, of course, but just the fact that you can go through and change some things here. So we can very easily change the image from WordPress to the client's logo or your own logo if you're branding it. Maybe you want to brand it for your company. You can change the link. You can change the alt text. You can change the background color on the page, the button color. And you can change anything here. I don't usually go crazy. It doesn't take a lot to, but really just a color change and a logo just makes a world of difference in how that's perceived. The professional edge that I think it gives your login screen is nice. And it's also reassuring for your client. They know they're on the right site. For me as a developer, it's nice. I know I'm logging into the right site. So I log into lots of sites. So this snippet of code, and I'd like to say actually this snippet and the next snippet Both originally came from a theme called Bones by a guy named Eddie Machado, and this was just the first place I saw those snippets, so credit where credit's due. So this is the little snippet about changing the login stuff, and the first function basically just gives the path of a login.css file. You still need to create that login.css file, but if you're comfortable just using the browser inspector, you just go in the browser inspector and you find the element for the logo, change it up. I don't usually have a lot of lines in that file, but it's just quick and easy. And then the next two functions are just changing the link and also putting in the name of the blog for that alt text. So basically there's three functions, and then there's the three hooks which pull it, filters I should say, well, hooks, that attach those functions to the WordPress hook names. The next thing that I usually try to do, especially because I make a living selling WordPress themes, is I like to change up the bottom of the admin. So if you've ever looked in the bottom left-hand corner, there's this little link there that says, thank you for creating with WordPress. And while I am incredibly grateful to WordPress for the way I make a living, it's a hell of a lot more helpful for my clients to actually know who I am and how to contact me. So I usually put in a link to my website, and I put in an email link. And I found this is particularly helpful with organizations with high turnover. So if you're doing websites for student organizations or nonprofits, you know, it could be, you know, 3 or 4 years before anybody has the money to change their website or the desire. And at that point, nobody has any idea. So this is also just a way that you might get yourself some repeat business or a headache. But so again, this is another super small snippet. It's literally a function with the HTML that you want to use. You want to keep the same, you know, ID tag there, and then we're going to just hook this function into the WordPress hook called admin footer text. And if you're not familiar with hooks and filters, I definitely recommend learning them if you're a developer, but they are basically a way to, I'm going to get this menu off the bottom of my screen. There we go. Menu is still hiding it. They're a way to customize WordPress plugins, core, or theme, but in a way where you're putting the customizations on in your code, in your functions.php file, in your theme, and you're not going and trying to, you know, edit core directly or edit a plugin. They're essentially the proper way to be customizing code in WordPress that's not yours. So a lot of the sites that I build, I'm using custom post types to add different types of content to a site. And even if you're not familiar with the term custom post types, you've probably used a plugin that's created them. If you have a calendar plugin, it's created an events custom post type. In this example, I've created a movies custom post type. And this is just a sample of what the screen would look like if I created a movie custom post type, and I have a genre taxonomy that I'm using to categorize my movies. And so what I see here is the normal list. I've got my name of the movie. WordCamp Miami had an 80s theme, so you can see a theme here of 80s movies. I can see the author, I can see the genre, comments, and a date. But if I'm a client managing a movie database, it would probably be a lot more helpful for me to see maybe the release date and to maybe not have that other stuff on there. Like, I don't really care who wrote the post, especially if I'm a single owner blog. I don't really care how many comments there were if I don't have comments turned on. So it's actually fairly simple to modify this list. And this is two snippets, the first two functions. The first one, I'm basically taking away the columns I don't want, and then I'm also adding an additional column. I'm literally just adding the column here. The second function is where I'm actually specifying, when I get to that column, how I'm generating what goes into it. So in this example, I'm taking out the author, comments, and date, and then I'm adding a column called release date. The really interesting thing about this is you can even take out the columns using these unset calls, add your own columns, and then re-add them if you want. So even if you just want to rearrange the order of the columns, you can do that by essentially taking them out and then putting them back in. And then in the second function here, I've added a new field called release date, And then this is the code where I'm just processing, and I'm literally just pulling the data from the custom field. What's even better than that? Oh, actually, one thing when I go back. So you may notice in this example that there's a couple words in pink here, and I wasn't getting overly crazy with the 80s coloring. I highlighted that in a different color because these hook names are specific to the slug of your custom post type. So in this case, the hook has that word movies in it. If you were operating on an events post type, you would replace that with events or whatever the slug for your custom post type is. So the hooks are very specific to the custom post type. And then the next best thing to just having the data there is, of course, is that in certain cases, it's really helpful to be able to sort on that data. So it's one thing to see the data, but all the other columns that WordPress brings in are sortable. So this is two additional functions that you can use to make the columns that we just added sortable. So the first one is essentially just adding the column name to the list of what is actually sortable. And then the second one is where we're actually modifying what the query parameters are when it loads that page. So in our case, we are telling it, okay, if they've sorted on that column, then we're going to sort on the meta key, the custom field, and then that field name is release-year. And you can have as many fields as you want here. I just have a single field here because that's how I fit it on one slide. But you can have as many extra fields as you want, and that's also where taking out those other fields can be really helpful, because if you add four fields to the list, you're going to be, you know, four columns to your list page. Unless you have a super big monitor, it's going to be get really hard to read. Things get very squished. So I like the fact that you can take out columns that you don't need as well. The other thing to know is, like, when you have Yoast SEO installed, Yoast puts his columns there, which are great if you really need to know SEO on those. If you're not really using those columns or they're not that important, you can take them out as well. You know, and you're doing it per post type, so you can see the little text in pink on that first function where, again, it's specific to the post type. So this is a really powerful tool if you're adding a lot of custom post types. They don't even have to be your custom post types. They can be, you know, maybe you have a plugin that's in use and they have a bunch of fields that your client isn't using. You can just take those out, declutter. Maybe they're confusing your client. Maybe you just want to take them out to make space for new fields. So it's any custom post type there, even posts and pages. You know, if your client's very confused about the comments or doesn't want to see the comments, I shouldn't say confused. I make it sound like all clients are confused, but really the whole goal of these snippets is that I am trying to make it a better experience in the back end. So
what's that code written? Is that PHP?
That's PHP. Yeah, these are all snippets in PHP, and they would all be dropped into your child theme. So if you're going to be customizing your, they could be in a plugin, but I usually am dropping them in a theme. So normally on a site, you would have a theme, and if you wanted to make these kind of customizations, you would make what's called a child theme, which is pretty straightforward, and you have a functions.php in there, and all of these can just be dropped into that file.
So it's in the functions.php.
It's in the functions.php, yep. So another great feature is when you do add a custom post type, WordPress is wonderful in that I added this genre taxonomy, and it does add it as a column. There's a flag when you create that taxonomy that puts it in a column, which is great. But it's also really helpful to be able to filter on it, which WordPress does not do for you. So if you've ever noticed when you go look at your posts, it has a filter right there for category, which is very convenient. You like, oh, I know it was a press release. I don't know when it was. You can filter, you know, on whatever the category is for your posts. But it doesn't do that when you have custom post types. So we're going to add a filter for our genre taxonomy, which I feel like will help us find our movies a lot easier. So this snippet it's actually written in such a way so that at the top of it, you can specify, you can use it for more than one custom post type. And basically, you're checking the custom post type, and then you're creating an array of which taxonomies you want to add filters for. You can add as many as you want. Again, they're going to keep taking up room on the screen, so you know, you're only going to have so many that you can see across, but usually one or two is all you need. And then the second bit of the code just loops through whichever of those taxonomies is, you know, whichever post type you're on, and we'll add those taxonomy filters. So it doesn't, you can use this function to add it to multiple post types, but you you don't need to repeat most of the code. So the other thing I really like to do is if the site is has a very distinctive style, I find it can be really helpful to make the content editor in WordPress look like the site. And I use this example of a dark background and a light color because it's the most visually striking different for the user. So rather than the user having to type things up, hit preview, see what it looks like, realize that the headings and the content editor don't look anything like the front end of the site, what we can do is we can apply our own CSS to this editor window and it gets applied just to that spot. And I find it's, yes, it's very helpful. Everything here is hopefully helpful. I might not have gotten a lot of sleep in Miami, so I apologize if I repeat myself. So this is actually a built-in function to WordPress called add editor style, and it gets hooked into a hook called admin init. And if you just call add editor style as is, it's going to automatically look for a file that's called editor-style.css. But you can add multiple files or just add a file with a different name by using the second example here, and you'll notice that it's commented out. But you can also call add editor style and give it a custom file name or a custom path in this case. And one thing that I recommend if you're using SAS in your theme development, one of the great things that you can do is take all of your font, text, heading styles and put them all into one module, into one file. And then when you set up your SAS files, you can compile that one into those snippets into both your editor style and your regular style. And what that does is it means that you just don't have to copy them. So if you're just using, you know, a single CSS file and then you decide to add this editor style, you've got to take your styles, copy them over into editor-style. You've got to update them if you change them later. So if you're using SAS especially, or even if you're just using segmented CSS files, you know, multiple CSS files, if you can not repeat yourself, it will make your life easier. And it's very easy to do that if you're using SAS. You can also use Google Fonts in here. So if you're using Google Fonts on the front end of your site, obviously, you're only going to get so close to how it looks if you don't have the Google font on the back end. And by default, normally, you're only putting the Google fonts on the front end. So this is using the same add editor style function. We can bring our Google fonts into that editor window. And the only trick with this is a lot of the Google fonts, if you're using more than one font or more than one font weight, have commas, and you need to make sure they're encoded. I'm not sure why that is, but... Yes.
A different way of enqueuing the fonts?
Well, this isn't enqueuing them on the back end.
Okay.
It's putting them in the admin area, whereas when you enqueue them, well, you can enqueue stuff at the back end, but normally when we talk about enqueuing for themes, we're enqueuing stuff on the front end.
Yeah.
But this is a way to enqueue it. It's not even just, I guess it's not even just on the back end, because there's a different way to enqueue things for the, just generally for the back end, for the admin. This is enqueuing them specifically for the tiny MCE editor window that appears there. It's not going to change all of the other fonts on the page. It's only going to affect what's typed into that box.
Thanks.
No problem. And so as you can see here, I loaded a very different kind of Google font. And you can see how for a customer, for a client editing, any kind of user editing this site, then it's just a lot easier for them if they're seeing, you know, what you see is what you get. The whole point of the tiny MCE editor is that it is a WYSIWYG. What you see is what you get editor. But really, in the case of WordPress, most of the time, that's not. You know, it doesn't look, your site normally isn't necessarily white with that particular font. It's usually very different. So, yes?
Can you do it for the titles?
For the headers and stuff?
No,
for the titles?
Title.
Oh, no. No, because that's, no.
It's not.
No, it's just applying it to this box. I mean, you could write some admin CSS. That particular snippet would not work for it, but you could enqueue an admin CSS file that targeted that input box. Yeah, you could. I never thought of that, actually. It's good. But that snippet won't do it for you.
Change that at all? Like, I was trying to change that having from the font and make it bigger or smaller.
I haven't tried to do it.
You not like documenting it, but I mean, just in general?
Yeah, well, you can. So in your theme, so in the same way that you can enqueue CSS files for the front end, there is a different hook that's, I don't remember exactly what it is, but it's essentially like, you know, admin enqueue scripts or something like that. And so you can apply CSS and JavaScript to your admin area too. I mean, I do caution you to be really careful, particularly with JavaScript. But so I don't see why you couldn't style that title.
That was just crazy, because I can style what's in that box. You get all the drop down, the bold, the this, the that.
Yep.
I was just like, oh, I want to change the color of having fun from black to like a different color.
I think you could do it. You want to look for the admin in QCSS, not this editor.
It's in there.
Well.
But that's what it takes to put on your page. That's what's having fun yet. It's in black.
Well, but see here, this is where you're editing it. So this is literally just, you know, an input box in a form. And so it's just generic styling. It doesn't know what you're applying it. And you don't want to apply it to probably all of the input fields in your WordPress admin. So you'd also want to really target it for the edit screen. But I don't see why it couldn't be done.
But my point was having fun yet shows up on the page, right?
On the front end.
Yeah, I don't know. I couldn't figure out how to style it.
Oh, you're talking about on the front end when you visit.
Yeah.
Yeah. You just.
But it's not as simple as like the box down there. Like, you know what I mean? Like in the text.
No, because it's controlled by your theme. So it depends on your theme. But if you know a little CSS and you want to install Jetpack custom CSS, you can target it. It's usually pretty easy to target the title and the page, but it does take a little bit of just understanding of HTML elements and CSS. Mm-hmm. And it could be, the thing is with some themes, it just depends how the styles are written. Some themes are very tricky to override the styling. Basically, the deal with CSS is it will apply the most specific style first. So if let's say in the theme it might say, you know, body, you know, hash, I don't want to say hashtag, but you know, pound sign main dot entry dash content h1, and then it might put a font. Well, if you write a style that just says h1 font family Comic Sans, it is applying that style, but then it's saying, oh, I have this much more specific style, I'm going to apply that one over it. So there's a hierarchy in CSS. So you sometimes, what I really recommend is there's two things you can do. One is use the browser inspector to see exactly how they're phrasing their CSS and use the exact same phrasing or more specific. There's a couple dirty tricks you can use beyond that. A friend of mine taught me that you can actually add the same class name twice. So let's say there's like dot entry content, you can say dot entry content, connected, no space. The other thing you can do is at the end of whatever CSS value you have, you can put a space and then you put exclamation point important, and it's like an absolute override. And unless your theme is also using important and the same or more specific style, you can override it then. But yeah, it just depends on your theme how hard it is to do it. It's not enough to add the CSS. You have to really, like, know what CSS is being applied. And I highly recommend just whatever developer tools come with the browser. You can usually look at that specific element, and you can see all of the CSS that's being applied. And whatever they show you at the top is the most specific CSS and is what they're applying. And then you'll see underneath, you'll see other CSS with other values that's getting overwritten because it's going to go for that most specific style. So... Okay. Yeah, and a lot of themes these days have a custom CSS somewhere in their options. It's pretty common these days. So if you're using a theme that you bought from somewhere else, I would look in the options page because it probably has a custom CSS in there. And then with that, hopefully, it's also very intelligently placing it after its own styles so that you're able to override more easily. So this snippet, I did have to cheat. This is on two slides. I couldn't fit it on one slide and expect that you could see anything. So this first function is just adding the drop down that we're going to add. I should have showed you a screenshot of what it looks like first, but we'll get there. So we basically are just saying, hey, we're going to add this style select code for the TinyMC editor. And this is this particular piece of code you would just stick in as is. You don't want, there's nothing to change here. You just put it in there. And then this second function, this is the one that can that you would be customizing. This then is where you create the styles that you want to put in that dropdown. And I just have one style here, but basically each style is its own little array element here. And if I wanted, I'm adding here blue title, I could add a comma after the end of that array, and I could add as many other whole arrays like that. And what I'm providing here is the title, so that's the text that's going to show my dropdown. And then this second line is really the key line. This left side is going to say, it's either going to say inline or block, depending what kind of element you want to add there. And then the right side of that is going to be the actual HTML element you want created. And the way that you use it in the editor is you type whatever text you want, you highlight it, and then you would select this style from a dropdown. It's super helpful when you may have gotten a design from a designer where there's some very specific styling that they want in the middle of the content editor window, as opposed to like on the menu or the footer or somewhere else that you have a lot of control over. You don't really want your clients to have to go in and custom type class names or styling to get in there. So this is a way to give them an interface to do it. And then the last line of it is the actual class that gets applied to the element. So in this case, if I have some text and I highlight it and I pick blue title, it's going to create me a div and it's going to give it a class of blue-title. Now, it's still my responsibility then to write the CSS for blue-title and put it into my style.css and hopefully my editor style.css so that something actually happens. This will just create the element. It's still up to you to style it after that. And again, I just have one in here, but you can have as many styles as you want. One thing that I find that this can be really helpful for is if you've ever had a site where the client or user wants to use the heading styles again and again, they're like, oh, I really like how this H3 looks. I'm going to stick a whole bunch of H3s and H2s all over my page. And if you know anything about SEO, you know that completely messes with Google's ability to understand your page and really understand the important points. So if they're wanting to use those heading styles for purely cosmetic purposes, you can actually just create copycat styles and put them in this dropdown and say, no, go use this style over here, and just kind of train them not to do that. Obviously, if they are important titles, then they should be using the heading styles to give Google that information. But, if they're just using them because they're pretty, this is another way to then help your SEO. So let me show you what this looks like. I should have probably showed that first. But so the first thing you have to know is that it puts it on the second line of the editor. So if you're only looking at the first row of the editor, you want to click this toolbar toggle on the right-hand side. I miss what it used to say, which was show, hide, kitchen, sink. But toolbar toggle is more boring, but it's a nice alliteration at least. And then when you click that, the second row will appear. And then this format dropdown all the way on the left is the dropdown that we've added. And in this case, we've only added one item, blue title, but that is displaying there if I click on it. So again, I'm going to highlight my text, and then I'm going to go click this, just like I would with a heading or the paragraph tags. And then if I have my editor style applied, then that's what it's going to look like if I use it in my editor. At least if you used the static web blue boring coloring. dashboard widgets. So this was a fun one. The first time I looked this up, I was like, oh, that's actually really easy. So dashboard widget, my thinking is if your client needs to process things when they go into their site, whether it's pending registrations, or in my case, you want to see like the recent movies, or maybe it's users that need to be approved or something, you can create a dashboard widget. The top function here essentially just says, here's my slug for my widget, here's the name of my widget, and then the third thing is, here's the function that's going to produce my widget. And then in this example, this wouldn't be your dashboard widget, but then the second function I have here is my dashboard widget, and I'm literally just writing a WP query, doing a WP query call, and pulling up the 5 most recent movies. And then when I display them, when I loop through them, I'm creating an edit link to my edit post page, and actually appending the release year there. So that custom field that we added to our post list before, I'm also putting that in my dashboard widget. So again, this is just for illustration. You don't have to be creating edit links, but you can basically put whatever kind of information you think your client might need, whatever information would be helpful for them to see right in front of them. Again, especially great if it's not somebody who's very tech savvy, if they can log in and see it right away. The only thing you need to know is that when this widget gets added, it's going to get added to the bottom of the screen. So you do need to tell them to drag it back up to the top of the screen so they can see it. So yeah, in our case, then this is what it looks like. I just said recent movies, and I have my movies listed there with my release date. Admin bar link, again, this is all about just accessibility and not in the usual use of the word accessibility, I guess, in web circles, but making things easy to find. So sometimes a client has a particular, I'm just sticking with my movie example here, so let's say that's really the piece of the site that they're managing all the time. You can add, this is just an admin link. You can actually also add whole admin menus of links, but what I usually find is there's one particular page, like an order management page or something like that, whatever they use. It doesn't have to be your own page. It can be just whatever page in the admin they normally need to go to most often. It could be for a plugin. And then basically you can add it to the link top, and you can also give it a class. So in here I've given it a class called movies-admin-link. So if you add some CSS to your admin, not to your front-end style.css, but if you add some admin CSS, you can also style that link, so you can make it like bold, three size, the normal font, or whatever you need to do to get their attention. So in here, I didn't really do any styling on it, but I just added a manage movies link up there. So now if my client comes in, they see the recent movies, they can click on those to edit, they can click manage movies at the top, they're being presented with a wealth of ways to get where they need to go, hopefully. And then the last thing I just want to talk about is a help page. If you're adding, I like to put help in the admin. Again, it's all about making it easy for the user. So if they need a lot of help pages, I've actually been tending lately to use the WP Help plugin, which lets you create, you or them create help posts in the admin, and they show up in a widget, and they're pretty straightforward. But sometimes I want to just create a single help page, and I just want to give them some information. Oftentimes it's like, here's how you use the short codes, or here's where the, sometimes I'll link to external documentation, like, here's the documentation for the event calendar, here's the documentation for, you know, inserting a YouTube video, or whatever it is. So this first function is just creating the menu page, and you just pass it the page title, what the menu title is going to be, what the permissions are that they need to see it. So you can put something in that's specifically just admins or editors and up, and then the last part of that is the actual function name. And then you can see down below, I didn't actually put anything in this help function, but what this help function would produce would be, you would want it to be the HTML for the help page. And again, usually for me, that's just how to use something or links to something. So that is what I have for you. So I hope that these snippets are helpful and that you don't install a plugin when you can do it yourself. What are we doing on time? Yeah, we can do questions. Okay. We can questions, or I can go back to any of the links. Yes?
Admin.css files, would that go in the child theme?
They go in the child theme, but you also need to enqueue them. So just like you would enqueue your style.css in your child theme, you need to enqueue admin CSS, and it's a different hook than it is to enqueue for the front end. So it makes sense, you know, you're loading different pages, and I guess maybe I should add an example in here of that. But if you look up enqueuing admin CSS, there's a particular hook for it, and it works just like the front end. Like I said, it's just that there's a different hook you use. Yeah, you're welcome. Yes?
Do you have any tips or tricks if we're going to be playing around with functions.php to not bring the entire site down?
So the question was, any tips or tricks for when editing the functions.php for not taking your whole site down? My first tip is do not be using the file editor that is inside the admin area. Right. And the reason I say not use that is because if that's the only way you're editing that file and you make a typo, which that's all it takes in PHP is one character missed, if that's the only way you have to access that file, you now cannot change that file again. So first of all, I always recommend using FTP so that you're editing the file locally and then pushing it up. Well, there's a few simple tricks like I always take out the ending bracket on the page, the closing tag on the page, because if you accidentally have stuff after that, it will cause problems. I recommend using a development IDE program so that you're editing your PHP not in Notepad, but in something that's going to color code and tell you. So I use NetBeans, it's free, but there's plenty of other ones. I don't know if you have some recommendations on other
editors.
PHP Storm.
$90 a year.
Okay, yeah, so it's a premium one, it's a good one. But so I use NetBeans, and basically it not only color codes things, but it will show me when stuff is wrong, so it'll show me errors. So I've seen that I mistyped something or I've forgotten a semicolon before I even push the file. You know, like it'll let me save the file, sure, but it's going to show me. And in NetBeans, it shows me like right on the end any warnings are you know, in orange and then red. So just using that helps you catch the errors before you make them. Obviously, if you push the file to the site and something happens, you want to bring it back. I'll like cut everything out and paste it in again bit by bit. You know, so if you put a few functions in, you know, it depends on what you're writing. But and of course, you could develop locally, and then at least you're only taking. Staging site, yeah, all good tips and tricks, yeah. Yeah, but it will happen. It'll happen. I think the biggest thing is don't panic. Make sure you know how to undo whatever you just did. If you're not super comfortable in PHP, what I can recommend is when you bring down the file locally and then when you're ready to upload the new file, go to the server, right-click on that functions.php, you know, make it functions.back. .php or something or .back at the end, and then upload your new file. And that way it's super easy if you did something wrong to at least just undo, you know, go back to the other file.
Are there good what's a good utility to do to backup or restore?
Well, in this case, we're just talking about the one functions.php file. But back and restore, a lot of web hosts do backups for you, especially if they're WordPress hosts. I use Backup Buddy a lot. Duplicator is good. Updraft Plus.
Is that a WordPress thing or is that a site
thing? It's a WordPress plugin, but it's a premium plugin. But it makes it really easy to move sites.
WP Migration is really good.
Oh, WP Migrate DB?
Yes.
That's amazing. So let me go over the backup plugins first, and then I'll talk about that for a minute. So some free ones, though, are called Duplicator. And the Duplicator, the end of it is an OR. That's a free one that's good. Updraft Plus is also good. I find it's a little cumbersome to work with because it backs things up in chunks.
But that's an offsite if you want.
But yeah, well, all of these have, I think, have offsite solutions, except maybe Duplicator. And Updraft Plus has a premium version too. So the plugin that the gentleman in the back was mentioning, WP Migrate DB Pro, it's by a company called Delicious Brains. It is really great for moving database. Yeah, something seems my thumbs up. It's great for moving databases, so it's really good if you're a developer moving stuff from, like, your local system to the staging server. Basically, you have the plugin installed on both sites, and you put a little secret key in, and you can push and pull data. So,
I'm sorry, it's actually...
Oh, you're talking about a different plugin?
Yeah, it's one even better, where you can move your whole site really conveniently.
Okay.
And that's all-in-one WP migration.
Okay, all-in-one WP migration. All in one WP migration.
Found
my list.
It's free.
Yeah.
It moves the entire site.
The other MigrateDB that I was just talking about doesn't actually move the whole site, but that's what I want in that case. But it does have an add-on where you can also move the media library files. So it's really helpful. Like in my case, I've got multiple developers working locally, but there's a staging site. So it would be like, oh, I need to do some content edits. You know, I will grab the staging site DB, bring it down, make some stuff, and then push my changes back up. So it's very helpful. I'm going to check out that backup plugin because everybody's always fighting over those. And it's always like something doesn't work. Some site's backup buddy doesn't work on. Yes? Oh, I've heard of that one, yeah.
Yeah, which also does it all.
Okay. Free? You like it?
Free, yeah, I do like it. Yeah, it's open source.
Okay.
And very good support. Within an hour or so, you'll get free support. But mostly it just works.
Within an hour or so, you get free support? Is that what you just said?
Yeah, right.
These people are making a bad name for the rest of us. That's great. All right, so yeah, if for those who didn't hear for the video, X-Clone was recommended as another free backup plugin.
I'm just wondering if Dreamweaver is outdated for an editor.
I haven't used it in a while. Does it do PHP? I mean, I know you can edit PHP in it, but I don't know if it does the color coding. Does it? Okay, so yeah. I think that's fine. I mean, there are some advantages when you get into something like more of an IDE. So when I'm working with NetBeans locally, one of the nice things is I have all of the WordPress files there. So if I run if I want to know exactly what a WordPress function does or what the parameters are or something, I can right-click on it, go see the definition. It's helpful when I'm trying to like manipulate plugins, like to be able to just jump right to that definition and figure out if there's a hook there I can use or if it's even doing what I want, kind of thing. So, but Notepad++, I mean, you're still getting the formatting help, and that, so, you know, on the scale of helpfulness, it is helpful, and then there are other things you could use that might be more. But the thing is, if Notepad++ is what you're comfortable in, and it's you're getting the helping and coloring, then that's fine, that's still good. But if you're doing some more editing and you need, you know, if you are taking your site down by, you know, editing your functions.php, then it might be worth looking into something that provides a little stronger help. Great. Well, thank you, guys. I'm going to stick around for a little bit. So those of you, anybody has more questions or want to talk about something less related to this, feel free to hit me up. Thank you.